We'll get started with the lecture today. So we'll just take a quick recap of what we studied in radiation 2 yesterday. We said that there is a black body, and the black body, what is the nature of the black body? Black body has three characteristics. One is it is a perfect emitter, perfect absorber, and it is diffuse. It has no preference for direction. So, and then we said that the emissive power of a black body is given by sigma T to the power of 4, and this is what is called a Stefan Boltzmann law, thanks to the efforts of both Professor Stefan and Professor Boltzmann. So, this is the relation which was given by Boltzmann, okay, and I mean derived by Stefan and Boltzmann. Stefan found this by experiments, that is simple empirical correlation, simple curve fitting, but Boltzmann did the derivation of sigma to get us 5.67 into 10 to the power of minus 8. Otherwise, that constant was obtained through theory. But the beauty is that the credit goes to Stefan because he chose T to the power of 4. That is the major credit. The power 4 is given by Stefan, and 5.67 into 10 to the power of minus 8 theoretical derivation is given by Boltzmann. The very fact that Stefan had the ingenuity to choose T to the power of 4, that is where his contribution comes. The very fact that the heat transfer, the delta T, it is the temperature difference is not no longer linear in case of radiation, he had perceived that through that relation. That is the beauty of empiricism. People make a criticism always that, oh no, this guy has done experiments and just given the empirical relations. Only when you make an observation, you can start thinking of explaining it. If there is no observation, how do you explain it? So, the first thing is, first step in research is that one has to go and make observations. Something is decreasing, something is increasing. Now, we will start thinking, how do we explain this increase or decrease? That is how the research progresses. So, we should not be criticizing people who are making observations and giving us correlations. But if we should criticize those people if they do not explain it to us, those correlations. So, we should try to make an attempt to explain the experimental correlations, whatever we are arriving at in whatever research we are doing. So, then the cavity can be visualized as a black body. Black body, the cavity is a perfect absorber and an emitter. And spectral black body emissive power is the amount of the radiation energy emitted by a black body at an absolute temperature T per unit time, per unit area, per unit wavelength. This is what is Planck's distribution. And we have Planck's constant and C naught. Do not forget this C naught. C naught is the mother of all everything here. The very fact that C naught you see here, that itself suggests that my electromagnetic wave is nothing but light. That itself suggests that it is light. So, it is the velocity of light in vacuum, 2.998 into 10 to the power of 8 meters per second. So, k equal to 1.3805 into 10 to the power of minus 23 joule per Kelvin, universal Boltzmann constant. Now, you can see Boltzmann's, why it is called as Boltzmann constant. Okay. So, Max Planck did this, and if we put emissive power for a black body, which is pi I b, because it is a diffuse emitter. So, I get pi I lambda b. So, if I substitute that, I get new constants C 1 and C 2. C 1 equal to 3.742 into 10 to the power of 8 watt per meter to the power of 4 upon meter square. C 2 equal to h C naught by k equal to 1.439 into 10 to the power of 4 micrometer Kelvin. Okay. Now, this is the Planck's distribution what we have. So, I implore that in your classes you spend enough time in distributing this Planck's distribution. So, this is emissive power, this is wavelength, area under each curve gives me the net emissive power of the black body at that temperature. This is 100 and this is 5800. Why we have plotted 5800? Because that is almost equal to the sun's temperature. That is why it is called as, here it is written as solar also. So, in fact, I would request that you should request your students to plot this in Excel sheet. We have not copy pasted this figure from any textbook. We have plotted this in a grapher and drawn this graph. So if you plot it yourself, you will feel the numbers much better than otherwise. So, you have the emissive power and wavelength, and there is always a maxima. If I connect that maxima, you get lambda maximum into T equal to 2897.8 micrometer Kelvin. So, this is what is called as Wien's displacement law. So he is Professor Wien, okay, and if I integrate this with respect to all wavelength, covering all thermal radiation wavelength, I will be getting sigma t to the power of 4, where sigma is 5.67 into 10 to the power of minus 8 watt per meter squared Kelvin to the power of 4. So that is Stefan Boltzmann law. Okay. In fact, there is a paper on the history of Stefan and Boltzmann. I cannot upload the paper myself, but I will try to make a notes. Please note this down. I will try to make a notes on Stefan Boltzmann, but I can give the reference, so that might be available in if the journal paper is available at your end. Download that paper and read. It gives us the historical perspective of how the Stefan has done the curve fitting. It's a beautiful paper. I would recommend that all teachers should read that paper. If you don't have that paper, I will make the notes and send, because I cannot upload the paper. PDF paper I am not supposed to give because of copyright issues. I cannot give that journal paper. If you can download from your end, you can always download. So then we studied band emission, f of 0 lambda equal to e lambda comma b d lambda 0 to lambda upon sigma t to the power of 4. So if I put that, I represented that in terms of lambda t, and we said that if I have to know the fraction of the energy or the fraction of the emissive power which is emitted within the band of 0 to lambda 1, if I need that, I have defined what is called as f of 0 lambda. This is represented in terms of lambda t, and I have I lambda comma b lambda t upon sigma t to the power of 4, and this is I lambda comma b lambda t upon I lambda comma b at lambda maximum comma t. Okay. So with this, we solved a problem and we appreciated the importance of this table very much, and then we went ahead and defined four emissivities. That is, this is the emissivity in general is the radiation emitted by a surface upon radiation emitted by a black body at the same temperature. So that is why the emissivity, the spectral emissivity, here you see the emissive power of a real body is lower than the black body, number one, and number two is that it is having directionality unlike a black body. So that is the real surface. Now we defined four emissivities. One was spectral directional emissivity, and total directional emissivity, and spectral hemispherical emissivity, and total hemispherical emissivity. So we said that whenever directional dependence is there, directionality, I always handle it by intensity. Whenever directionality is not there, whenever I have averaged the intensity over all directions, then when there is no directional dependence, I handle emissive power. That is what we see here. Whenever directional dependence is there, spectral directional emissivity, you see theta comma phi, I am using I lambda comma e lambda theta comma phi t upon I lambda comma b lambda t. Okay. So next is, I get total directional emissivity, that is, I have again directionality, so that is why I have intensity again. So then spectral hemispherical emissivity, here I have come back to emissive power, because I have integrated over theta comma phi. Emissive power at lambda given by lambda at lambda comma t upon e lambda comma b lambda t. We related spectral hemispherical emissivity with the directional emissivity. So when we do that, we get some equation like this, and the next one is total hemispherical emissivity, that is emissivity equal to E of t upon E b of t, and of course you can represent this as epsilon lambda lambda t E lambda comma b lambda comma t. This is what we had defined just little while ago, that is this. So if I substitute this, this is what I get. Applying this relation, I solved a problem. This is what applying, this is the application of that relation. I solved a problem wherein which I have taken for this bandwidth, that is 0 to lambda 1, I have epsilon 1, and between lambda 1 to lambda 2, it is epsilon 2, and between lambda 2 to infinity, it is lambda 3. That is why I get epsilon at the t. What is this? I said average emissivity. What is this actually? This is spectrally averaged, perhaps, if it is, nothing is mentioned, perhaps it is hemispherical emissivity. It is averaged. That is why we have put average. So do not get carried away. Average, it is actually spectrally we are averaging right now, and it is perhaps the hemispherical emissivity. So I get epsilon 1 f 0 lambda 1 t, epsilon 2 f lambda 1 to lambda 2 plus f plus epsilon 3 f lambda 2 to infinity. How do I get f lambda 1 to lambda 2? It is f 0 to lambda 2 minus f 0 to lambda 1. If you see, one another thing I want to tell is, we all think through images. Another insight what I have learnt with time is that, whenever I tell something, what should come in the back of my mind is the image. So, when I say f lambda 1 to lambda 2 equal to f 0 to lambda 2, what is the image which should come to my mind is that, my image should be, I should visualize that and tell, otherwise perhaps I am not telling with that feel. That is, if this is the emissive power and this is the lambda, when I say lambda 1 to lambda 2, this is lambda 2 and this is lambda 1. So, that is f of lambda 2 to lambda 1 means, it is f of 0 to lambda 2 minus of f of 0 to lambda 1. Okay? So, the point is, what I am trying to say is, we all think through pictures actually. See, that is what always everyone tells. See, when I always take this example, that is, whenever I remember my mother, my mother's face comes to my mind. So, whenever I remember a concept, a figure should come to my mind, then only I have understood that concept. If I cannot get an image when I see a concept, then perhaps I have not understood that concept. So, whenever a concept I explain, it should be through an image, and that image should be recorded in my mind. If no image is recorded in my mind, I have not transmitted that concept to my students, and nor I have understood that concept myself. So, my point is we have to transmit concepts through images, through figures, figures, tables, graphs. These are the ones which we will remember very easily. You see, I think as teachers you all appreciate, you may not remember the names of your students, but definitely you remember their faces. When he comes to you, you will say, oh, I have taught you, but you will vaguely remember him, but you will not remember his name. That is precisely what I am saying. So, we all remember images. We may not remember exact relation, but we will remember concepts through images. That's what we need to emphasize while teaching. Okay. So, that is what we did, epsilon 1.3, epsilon 2.8 and 0.1, we did that integration and we got the value, the total hemispherical emissivity, we got it as 0.521. So, there is another problem, I am sure many enthusiasts would have solved that problem yesterday night. So, now let us move on to how does real surfaces do not emit radiation. Now, real surfaces do not emit radiation in a perfectly diffuse manner, because they are not black bodies, they have directional dependence. So, whatever graphs I am flashing, I am not going to reason them out, because it is quite difficult to reason them out. I will attempt to reason them out in the second half of today's lecture. Okay? So, please do not ask me questions for now, why is emissivity increasing, decreasing either with temperature or with direction. All that I can say for now is that they are all dependent on electromagnetic permeability and electric permittivity. Okay? So, they are dependent on that, whether it is a solid, liquid, gas. So, they are all dependent, that is emissivity, transmissivity, reflectivity, absorptivity, all these are dependent on electrical permittivity, electrical conductivity, magnetic permeability and the charge of the electrons. So, velocity of the electromagnetic wave in that medium. If you remember, I had put C equal to C naught by n. What is that n? Refractive index. So, we are going to define in the second half refractive, complex refraction index equal to refractive index minus I k, where is absorptive index. So, this n and k, complex index of refraction is given by n minus I k, that is m equal to n minus I k, where n is refractive index, which we have studied through Snell's law. I will touch that in the afternoon. K is the absorptivity index. this N and K are related to electrical permeability and electrical permittivity and magnetic permeability. I don't remember what is the notation for magnetic permeability, electrical permittivity and magnetic permeability. Okay. So, why am I telling all this? Epsilon reflectivity, transmissivity, absorptivity, they are all functions of N and K. So, that is what I am trying to say. For simple cases, I will try to give you relations between epsilon and N and K in the second half of today. I should not get into that now, because I have to cover that little, as teachers we should know little bit, although I also do not know completely, but little bit whatever I have understood from Modest, I am going to explain you in the second half. But now let us move on what we teach in the undergrads. So, emissivity is a function of direction. So, this figure demonstrates that the real surfaces are not diffuse surfaces. For conductors, see why I said electrical permittivity and magnetic permeability is because this conductors and non-conductors have different electrical permittivity. Okay. So, that will decide my emissivity, and this emissivity is having preference to particular direction for conductors and non-conductors. This is a general way. It is not that for all non-conductors it is going to be like that. Generally, for non-conductors, emissivity is higher than that of conductors, and non-conductors emissivity decreases continuously with theta, and this is, and here theta direction is shown. Okay. Theta is 0 means it is normal. Okay. So, with this let us move on. So, that is what is called as, when theta equal to 0, that is what is called as normal emissivity, because it is normal to the surface. So, now temperature dependence, like thermal conductivity, here also we have temperature dependence. The total normal emissivity as a function of temperature, if you see you get that for tungsten it is increasing, stainless steel it is increasing, aluminum oxide it is decreasing, heavily oxidized stainless steel it is decreasing. Again, I will take the recourse of permeabilities only. Okay. So, I have not explained you why it is increasing, decreasing. I have just stated that emissivity is a function of temperature. Now, and you can see that emissivity of polished metals is generally lower than emissivity of unpolished materials. See, yesterday for one of the questions of Professor Vivek, I was answering that a diffuse surface will have high emissivity. That is, an unpolished is towards diffuse, that is there is no glaze. If you see, in fact if you see the blackboard, most of our blackboards which we use, they are all diffuse actually, because of putting chalk over it again and again, they have become diffuse, they are not polished. So, blackboard will be having higher emissivity than the blackboard which I started using on the first day. So, polished metals, so if you want to increase the emissivity, polished metals should not be used, they should be used unpolished metals. And another thing, I do not know whether you have noticed or not. So, I think I will come to that example little later on, that is I wanted to explain the aluminum foil thing, I will come to that little later on. So, these are oxidized metals, and as you see here, you see human skin and water. Water is emissivity 1. I understood this in a hard way. See, actually one day I had a wonderful student by name Prabhul. He was one of the best students I had, and he was doing some two-phase flow experiments, and we had to heat the water in a tank, and we were supposed to take the tank temperature, that is the water temperature in the tank, to reach to 50 to 60 degree Celsius, and then do the experiments by maintaining the temperature at 50 or 60 degree Celsius. So, I went to lab one day, and every day I used to check the temperature of the water in the tank, so that I put off the heater or put on the heater by checking with the thermometer. But one day I went to the lab and Prabhul was measuring with the thermal camera, that is there is a thermal gun. See, I do not know how many of you, why I am taking this example, because I want to explain you how does the thermal gun works also. So, there is a thermal gun nowadays, what is that Taiwan make, Taiwan make thermal guns are available just for 5,000-6,000 rupees. If you can afford, I would request you to purchase thermal gun. It is actually called as thermal infrared gun. Also, few people loosely call it as camera also, although it is not, or they call it as thermal infrared laser also. Okay, these are various names. There is Fluke make. If you are very much interested, I can give you the address and the supply person of this Fluke make. You get a simple thermal camera. Fluke is little expensive. Expensive means it comes to around 25,000 to 30,000 rupees. If you cannot afford that much, we get Taiwan make thermal cameras also. So this Taiwan make thing we had, which is hardly 4,000-5,000 rupees. Prabhul was just measuring the measuring the temperature of the water with that gun. He said temperature is 40 degrees Celsius without putting thermometer. I used to put the hand gloves and put the thermometer because water was hot and things like that. So from Prabhul I learned that emissivity of the water is one. How did I learn that emissivity of water is one? Because in a thermal gun, I should fix the emissivity, then only I will get the temperature. Okay. So if I know the emissivity of a surface, the thermal gun gives me the temperature. So on that day he was getting directly the temperature. Why? Because the emissivity of water is 1. Emissivity of water is 1. So he said, sir, thermometer reading and the thermal gun reading are matching. He also didn't know that emissivity of water is 1, but they are matching. From that we realized that emissivity is 1. We referred back to books and we saw that emissivity of water is indeed 1. In fact, yesterday you have taken emissivity of ice also as 1. Okay. So the point is, what I want to tell is, a thermal camera or a thermal gun measures the heat flux, that is the thermal radiation. What is the thermal radiative heat flux? What is the thermal radiative heat flux? We have Stefan Boltzmann, emissive power. Stefan Boltzmann law says that it is sigma T to the power of 4. It gives it thermal camera, if this is my thermal camera, the input is radiative flux. That is E, that is sigma epsilon T to the power of 4. If I have a surface, if it is emitting, if I aim my gun towards the surface, it is going to capture sigma epsilon T to the power of 4. Remember, this is watts per meter squared. Watts per meter squared. That is why I call this as radiative flux. So now this gun gives. It gets the voltage output. This voltage output, actually, how does it get voltage output? Again, it is a simple resistor which is there inside. Because of this radiative heat flux, this resistor gets heated up. Because of this heating up, the resistance changes, and that change in the resistance is perceived as a change in voltage. Okay? So This is what is called as actually bolometer. That is, bolometer essentially consists of resistance, and when radiative heat flux is incident on the resistance, this resistance, the temperature of this resistance increases. So this change in the temperature is perceived as a change in the resistance, which is perceived as a change in the voltage, which is what we measure. And this voltage output is a measure of temperature. How can I get temperature? Can I get temperature directly here? No. Only if I know the emissivity, if I plug in emissivity in that camera, it will give me temperature. Okay? So what is thermal camera then? What is thermal camera? Thermal camera is a combination of multiple bolometers. That is a combination of micro bolometers. Thermal camera, micro bolometers. Micro bolometers. That is, in a thermal camera, you have, if you purchase a thermal camera or what, most of us have cameras with us in our mobiles. How do you specify a camera? Megapixels. You say 10 megapixels I have, 20 megapixels I have. Similarly, thermal camera also has pixels. Pixels means what? It is made of multiple squares. My camera is capturing my image using multiple squares. Multiple squares. So, 10 MB pixels means that many squares I have to make my image. In fact, my image is being transmitted to you through thousands of pixels, tens of thousands of pixels. That's how each square is a combination to make my image. Similarly, to get a thermal image, there is typically, if you go to market, you get 320 by 240 pixels, 320 by 240 pixels thermal camera. So, this 320 by 240 pixel thermal camera is, that means along this axis you may have 320 pixels and here you have 240 pixels. That means you have 320 on this direction and 240 squares in this direction. So, that many pixels you are going to form when you are making a picture, thermal picture. So, each pixel is what here? Each pixel is a microbolometer. Each pixel is a microbolometer, and each microbolometer has to be separated from the another microbolometer, otherwise resistances will become, one resistance will talk to another resistance. So, they have to be insulated. That is where micro machining comes into picture. This is micro in size, micron size. This complete microbolometer will be hardly 1 centimeter by 1 centimeter. Within that 1 centimeter by 1 centimeter, they have to embed 320 by 240 microbolometers, okay? And they have to be separated by insulators, electrical insulators. So, that is what is a thermal camera made of. So, coming back, if you have a thermal camera, in a thermal camera, what is that? It will give you radiative heat flux. Sigma epsilon T to the power of 4 it will give you. If you know the emissivity of a body, that is, you take a black paint, you take a sheet, you apply black paint with lamp black, that is candle soot, that is it. You get an emissivity almost as close as 0.98, 0.99. Of course, it cannot be used for high temperatures because lamp black will vanish at high temperatures. But at room temperatures are nearly up to 70 to 80 degrees Celsius, lamp black stays cool, there is no problem. So, for that body you can take epsilon. So, then you can, from, if you get the emissivity, if you fix the emissivity, thermal camera directly gives you the temperature. So, everyone keeps asking me in our lab, if you, because we have thermal camera, they keep asking us, okay, you have thermal camera, you get me the thermal camera, I will measure the temperature. No, it is not like that. I should be knowing the emissivity. If I know the emissivity only, we can measure the thermal camera. Someone will come and ask me, I have a tool rotating and machining is going on, I want to measure the temperature, come and measure, because you have thermal camera. That is the perception we have. No, thermal camera does not give me temperature. If I know emissivity only, I can measure the temperature. Now, why did I tell all this story? I told this story because I wanted to explain you how to measure the emissivity. Have I explained it? I have explained it implicitly. Let me explain it explicitly. That is, what do? I take a thermal camera and now I take a thin metal foil. This is thin metal foil. Thin metal foil, and I heat this metal foil. There are multiple ways of heating metal foil. You can make an iron box type heater using the nichrome heater. You can put the nichrome heater behind. Of course, before the heater, there should be insulating material, and after that also insulating material if you have. And if you heat this, then my metal plate gets heated up. Or you can take the thin metal foil and directly give DC power supply. Let us say it is stainless steel foil. You give directly DC power supply. How do you give DC power supply? How do you give directly DC power supply? Why is it made thin metal foil? Because I need to increase its resistance. R equal to sigma L by A. If my cross sectional area is less, my resistance will go up. Still, if I have to give direct DC power supply, here current will be very large, voltage will be very less. It's safe way. My students can touch the foil, I can touch the foil, you can touch the foil, nothing will happen. So, because the major culprit in electricity is voltage, not electrical current. Okay, if the current is high also no problem, even if it is 400 amps no problem, as long as the voltage is 1 or 2 volts I can touch it, there is no problem. Okay, so that is what here we do. If the resistance is high, current will be very large, voltage will be very less. You can put a transformer and achieve this. Inlet to the transformer you can have 220 volts and 15 amps, outlet of the transformer you can have high current but low voltage. That is one way, or you can get directly DC power supplies. Nowadays what, 5000, 10000 rupees you will get very good DC power supplies. You do not need large power. If you take some such DC power supply or AC supply and give directly, if it is AC supply, it has to be given through transformer or it has to be directly DC supply. DC supply means you have to purchase a DC power supply and connect to our AC supply and get the DC. Okay. So, if you do any of that, why am I doing all this circus? Because I want to maintain this stainless steel foil at certain temperature, at a constant temperature. Let me say I maintain that at a constant temperature. Now, I will put a thermocouple behind. Now, I put a thermocouple. Why? To get the temperature of this foil. So, thermocouple temperature I get. Now, I will use the camera, and in the camera there is a provision that I can change the emissivity. I will keep on changing the emissivity until my camera's temperature matches with the temperature indicated by the thermocouple. That emissivity what I have set in the camera will give me the emissivity of the surface. I hope you have all understood this. So, point is, how do I measure emissivity? This emissivity is not spectral emissivity. This emissivity is perhaps a sort of total hemispherical emissivity, because I am covering it, I am seeing the camera from all directions. So, it is sort of hemispherical, number one, and it is not spectral. Because why it is not spectral? Because this camera is typically, the cameras are between 3 micrometer to 15 micrometer. Typical thermal guns, whatever you purchase, they are between 3 to 15 micrometers. Why? Because you and I know thermal radiation is within this range. Okay. So, this range is covered for spectrally averaged between 3 micrometer to 15 micrometer in all directions. That is, total hemispherical emissivity is measured by a simple thermal camera. If you purchase 5000 rupees worth Taiwan make thermal gun, you can measure the emissivity. You can cook this, whatever setup, whatever I told now, you can build this experimental setup in your lab and cook up one more emissivity experiment. I know you measure emissivity in a little different way. When I interacted with the coordinators in the coordinator workshop, they have a setup similar to the one which we have. Based on the heat flux, they will measure the, they will take a black body and they will take an ordinary black body. Ordinary body try to maintain the same heat flux by operating, by changing the temperature, and see that at what temperature both the heat fluxes are same, and then equate that, and then you get the emissivity. Apart from that, this is another elegant way of measuring thermal, measuring emissivity. This way we would have introduced the student to the thermal gun. Another application which you have noticed or not, this example I always take. Why? Because this is very close and we would have, all of us would have noticed this. That is, when swine flu was observed, in NDTV and CBN, IBN, they were flashing in the airports, people were holding the thermal camera. People were holding thermal camera and they were seeing the people who were coming through the exit port. That is, they were seeing whoever is having temperature higher than 37.5 normal temperature, they were screened, they were taken to the doctor and asked for. That means, they were trying to see whether a person is having fever or not through the thermal camera. The beauty of thermal camera is that it is a non-intrusive measurement. Now, the person who is being measured also does not know that he is being measured. Okay. So, such a, and the, another advantage is that the emissivity of the surface is 1. So, I do not have to plug in any parameter in my thermal camera. So, thermal camera has some tremendous applications in real life, but we should keep in our mind what are the limitations of the thermal camera. Thermal camera does not give temperature, that is what we need to appreciate. Okay. So, with this let us move on. I digressed because I wanted to explain you how does one measure emissivity. In fact, if you want to get a perfect black body, there is a paint called Pyromark. There is a paint called Pyromark. They have very nicely, I do not know the composition of this paint, but this paint is a very good paint which can sustain blackness, that is the emissivity and absorptivity are closer to 1 even at high temperature of 1000 degree Celsius. But only thing is that we need to bake it, that is we need to keep the Pyromark after painting for we have to spray paint. We cannot paint it by brush, we have to spray paint it, number 1, and number 2 we have to, what is that, we have to bake it under furnace for keeping it at 200 degree Celsius for, let us say, 4 to 5 hours. That is what is called as baking. If you bake it with the Pyromark under a furnace, this will give me emissivity, absorptivity closer to 1 even at high temperatures. Okay. So, this also you can do in your lab by putting this. So, okay, coming back, so these are the range of the emissivities what we get for various materials, and similarly we have absorptivity. So, that is absorptivity and reflectivity and transmissivity, this we have defined in the yesterday's class, and these are the various definitions. I hope you have all gone back and brushed up yourself all these definitions. Remember that I am using, whenever I am using absorptivity, I am using the notation I, because I have to take care of intensity incident onto my surface. So, if you note that difference, all other definitions are going to be same. And absorptivity is a function of temperature. And another important thing, yesterday one of the professors during interaction asked, and I said I am postponing this question, that is emissivity depends on the surface temperature, but absorptivity is almost, if not completely, independent of surface temperature. But what does it, absorptivity dependent? Absorptivity depends on the temperature of the source at which the incident radiation is originating. Okay. So, why? Because you see, in this example which is shown here, there is a house, the radiation onto the house is from sun which is sitting at 5780 degree Celsius, and from trees which is sitting at 300 Kelvin. Okay. So, what is the emissivity or what is the absorptivity of tree? 0.9. What is the absorptivity of sun? 0.6. Sorry, absorptivity of sun is a wrong term. Absorptivity of my house, because of the incident radiation from the sun or because of the incident radiation of the trees. Because of the incident radiation of the trees, the absorptivity of my building is 0.9. On the other hand, absorptivity of my building because of the incident radiation of the sun is 5780. Absorptivity, how have I defined absorptivity? It is dependent on incident radiation. That means it should be dependent on the source, not the sink, that is the material which is emitting. It is not that. So, it is dependent on the incident, it has to come from the definition. It has to come from definition. If you see, how do I define absorptivity? Absorptivity is the net irradiation onto my surface. Okay. So, that means it has to depend on the source. So, you can answer your students that absorptivity is dependent on the source because it is coming from the definition. Okay. So, that is how we can answer why is absorptivity dependent on the source temperature but not the sink temperature. Okay. So, reflectivity, similarly we can define reflectivity, and I only take reflectivity for explaining reflectivity example Yesterday also I took this example. In a flask, I said that my flask material, if you have opened it, it's very flashy. Why? Because I want to have very high reflectivity, very high reflectivity. And I think you have all noticed, we use aluminium foils for packing our chapatis when we go in trains. When we are going traveling in train, we pack chapatis in, and even in train, we are served with chapatis which are rolled in aluminium foils. Why those, why aluminium foils? Why not some other plastic cover? Why? Because aluminium foil is having high reflectivity, very high reflectivity. So coldness, that is against coldness, no coldness can seep into my chapati. That's the point, that is the point. So no heat transfer is there from my chapati to outside. So that is why we can, we high reflectivity example can be quoted taking aluminium foil. Okay, even on, even if you see the if you take a pipeline and if you have put thermo wool, if you have put thermo wool around a pipeline, now thermo wool is put to basically control the conduction losses and convection losses. So you have put the thermo wool. Now over and above this thermo wool, you would have seen aluminium foils wound on that. Okay, very high reflective foils are wound on that. Why? Because reflectivity is to be avoided. Okay, I mean high reflectivity should be there. There is no radiation losses from the thermo wool to the outside atmosphere. Is that okay? Okay. So with this, we have the reflectivity. The reflectivity is defined. There are two ways of looking reflectivity. One is a diffuse surface. Another one is specular. Specular is like mirror. That is, whatever angle of incidence is equal to angle of reflection. So if that is the case, then it is called specular. Otherwise, it is diffuse. That is, it is equal in all directions. So we have similarly, we have transmissivity. All sorts of definitions: spectral, hemispherical, total hemispherical, and other definitions we can go ahead and define. This is just, I do not want to spend time here, why leaf is green. I think we all study this in plus 2, because it absorbs all other colors except that it emits only the green color. I think we say this again and again. So I think I will just solve this problem before I sign off. Okay. So I have spectral hemispherical absorptivity. This is the problem. How does spectral hemispherical reflectivity vary with wavelength? And what is the total hemispherical absorptivity of the surface? If the surface is initially at 500 Kelvin and has a total hemispherical emissivity of 0.8, how will its temperature change upon the exposure to the irradiation? So what is given? I have been given the absorptivity. What, which absorptivity I have been given? Spectral absorptivity. That is up to 0 to 8, I think, if I am right, this 0 to 8, it is having an absorptivity of 0.2, and from 8 to 10, let me see that I will be able to answer that now. Yeah, 0 to 6, 6 to 8, sorry, the figure is not clear, sorry about that. 0 to 6, it is constant, 6 to 8, it is increasing, and 8 to infinity, it is going constant. So now, irradiation is also having a distribution like that. Okay. So that is 0 to 2.02 irradiation is 0 to, no, that 0.2, to see this. This is 0 to 2, and 2 to 5 it is 500, and 5 to 12 it is 500 again, and 12 to 16 it is decreasing. So this is irradiation. So we will come back to that when we are solving. So this is irradiation distribution is given and absorptivity distribution is given. So taking that, the question asked is, find the spectral distribution of reflectivity and total hemispherical absorptivity and nature of the surface temperature range. So if I, this is my surface, and surface temperature is having 500 Kelvin, and emissivity is, total hemispherical emissivity is given to be 0.8, and emissive power is emissivity into Eb, okay, and irradiation is alpha into g. So alpha plus tau plus rho equal to 1, transmissivity of this surface is 0, so I get rho equal to 1 minus alpha. So now rho equal to 1 minus rho lambda equal to 1 minus alpha lambda. I have been given alpha lambda. So, at every wavelength, if I deduct 1 minus alpha lambda, I should be getting rho lambda. That is what I have done here, and I get rho lambda. I get rho lambda using this distribution. Now, what is the next? That gives me spectral distribution of reflectivity. Is that okay? Now, next is I have alpha lambda and g lambda given already. Now, what is that I need to do? Total hemispherical absorptivity. Have I defined that? Yes, I have defined that. Total hemispherical absorptivity is given by alpha lambda, g lambda, d lambda upon g lambda, d lambda, both integrated between 0 to infinity. This is like the way we defined total hemispherical emissivity. Similarly, we solved a problem based on which we took different emissivities in different bands. Similarly, we are taking different absorptivities in different bands. So, if I do that integration, see here in this range both absorptivity and irradiation are constant, that is 0.2 into g lambda d lambda between 2 to 6. During that time my g lambda is constant, and then g lambda is constant at 500 between 6 to 8, but between 6 to 8 my alpha lambda is increasing, okay. And plus absorptivity is 1 for 8 to 16, that is where between 8 to 16, what do I have? 8 to 12 it is constant, and then from 12 to 16 it is decreasing, that is what is accounted here. So, it is basically area under the curves. So, that integration I am doing, if I do that integration, I get total hemispherical absorptivity as 0.76. You please sit down over tea break, just do this integration. I am just doing simple integration by taking area under the curves. Now, what is the net heat transfer? Net heat transfer is alpha g, you see, alpha g minus e, epsilon e b. So, if I do that, alpha g minus epsilon sigma epsilon t to the power of 4, alpha we got 0.76, and g is, how did I get g as 5000? The integration of g, that is the area under this curve, is 5000. So, that 5000, if I substitute, and 0.8 is the emissivity which has been given, sigma, and this is T. What is this T? Surface temperature 500 to the power of 4, 3800 minus 2835, I get 965 watts per meter squared. What does this mean? It is coming out positive. That means it is receiving more than emitting. That means the temperature of my body should be increasing with time. So, the net heat flux to the surface is greater than 0. So, therefore, the surface temperature will increase with time. I think there is another problem with the cover glass. I am not going to do that here. This is about transmissivity. This problem was cooked to explain absorptivity, and this problem is cooked to explain transmissivity. So, I would request you to solve this problem yourself, and I will take maybe one or two questions. One question I will take before I sign off. So, yesterday we could not go to VJTI Mumbai. So, I am going to VJTI Mumbai. Please restrict your questions to today's topic or yesterday's radiation topic what was taught. Over to VJTI Mumbai for questions.
Hello, sir.
Please go ahead.
My question is, if I am getting the radiation from the sun, it is long wavelength or short wavelength radiation? And second question is, if I am using the window for the home purpose, I have the double glazed glass and one I have the single glazed glass, okay. So, the whatever the radiation coming inside through the solar is high or low, and it is which type of wavelength it is. From the solar radiation I am getting whatever the radiation is, short wavelength or long wavelength.
The question can be answered through Planck's distribution. So, let us see. If we take two, it is in radiation, that means it should be there in this itself. I am in radiation 2 itself. So, let us go to Planck's distribution. So, in fact, okay. So, if I see the Planck's radiation. So, If you see the Planck's radiation, what is solar radiation? 5800 Kelvin. 5800 Kelvin means, if you see here, the radiation, where is it? Visible light region is between around 0.5 to 1 micrometer. Okay? I do not know what you mean by short or large wavelength. Yes, if I have to answer that way, okay. The solar radiation, that way for any temperature, short wavelength will have higher emissive power compared to large wavelength. So is in case of solar radiation, the most of the energy is concentrated between 0.08 micrometer to maybe 1 to 5 micrometer. Okay? So, but then we cannot generalize like that, but generally this is the wavelength band which the solar radiation is occurring. Second question, you had the second question was, there is a double flare glass and a single flare glass, how do they work? I have to look at the transmissivity patterns. Until I see the transmissivity patterns, I will not be able to comment. What I would request you is to look for the transmissivity distribution of the single flare glass and the double flare glass. That is the answer for your question.
One more question.
Sir, you have just now given an example of aluminum foil that is wound on chapatis or pipes carrying hot fluids which are insulated. Can you just elaborate how these aluminum foils are going to reflect coldness, and aren't they going to reflect the heat also?
Yeah, they are going to reflect both cold and heat, both cold and heat. See, in the first example of chapati, I do not want to lose the heat. In the second example, when I am putting this aluminum foil maybe on a hot water pipe, which is let us say we have a hot water pipe and there is a flow taking place of the hot water in this pipe. Here I do not want to lose the heatness from my hotness of my, from my hot water. Here again aluminum foil avoids the any coldness which is coming from the for cryogenic fluids also you use aluminum foil. So it is no matter whether it is for heating application or cooling application, for all reflective, for avoiding reflection, we do put aluminum foils. Is that okay? I think we will move on. Professor Arun will take over and start off with Kirchhoff's law.